Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is George Guidel, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled Evolutionary Psychology Part 2, The Science of Human Nature, Friends and Enemies. Your professor will be Allen D. MacNeill. Allen MacNeill earned a B.S. in biology in 1974 and an M.A. in science education from Cornell in 1977. He has taught the support course for introductory biology at Cornell University since 1976. As a senior lecturer in the Learning Strategies Center at Cornell, MacNeill works with students taking both majors and non-majors introductory biology. In addition, he organizes and carries out in-service training for teaching assistants in biology and related fields. Allen also teaches evolution for the Cornell Summer Session and has taught the introductory evolution course for non-majors at Cornell. He has served as a faculty fellow at Ecology House and as an honorary member and faculty advisor for the Cornell chapter of the Golden Key International Honor Society. He has served on numerous advisory committees and editorial boards at Cornell and in the Ithaca community. Along with his many teaching assignments, Allen has appeared in a number of off-Broadway plays and in other acting venues. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites and a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students. And now, we begin Evolutionary Psychology Part 2, The Science of Human Nature, Friends and Enemies. Lecture 1, Dominance and Territoriality.
Why do we do what we do? In The Social Mind, the first series of lectures in this course on evolutionary psychology, we explored why people do what we do individually and in the context of our own social groups. But we don't live our entire lives alone, or even within the same social group. Human societies, like most animal societies, are composed of multiple social groups which interact with each other in complex and fascinating ways. This second series of lectures, Enemies and Friends, is about what happens when people in one social group interact with people in other social groups. And it is about how and why those things happen. People sometimes compete with members of their own social groups, but more often they cooperate with them in accomplishing various tasks that further their own individual interests and the collective interests of the groups of which they are members. These same two dynamics, competition and cooperation, determine the structure of human societies and how they interact, and also what happens to the individuals of which they are composed. Evolutionary psychology is about observing human behavior and trying to understand why we do what we do from an evolutionary perspective. Evolutionary psychology, like evolutionary theory in general, aims for a synthetic theory that includes both rigorous and unbiased observations of human behavior, including an examination of the contexts within which those behaviors occur, and an explanation of the underlying causes of those behaviors from the perspective of evolutionary biology. Many of the explanatory concepts developed by evolutionary psychologists have come from relatively simple observations of people in partially or fully controlled environments. Others have come from observing humans, both individually and in groups, from the perspective of an objective, outside, and ideally non-participatory observer. This is essentially the approach taken by anthropologists who, like ornithologists, study people in what we could call their natural habitat. Until recently, this has often meant that studying other so-called primitive cultures has been common, but studying contemporary humans in developed countries has been relatively rare. However, evolutionary psychologists have assumed that everyone is fair game and have studied people like us, the people listening to and also presenting this lecture series. Finally, some explanatory concepts in evolutionary psychology have come from studies of other non-human animals. This approach, while sometimes controversial, has yielded valuable insights into human behavior. This is because, as in the other natural sciences, similar causes produce similar effects. Comparative studies of animal behavior in similar ecological contexts can provide remarkable insights into the underlying causes of such behavior. This comparative method works because humans, like almost all primates, are intensely social animals. As we learned in the first lecture series, the evolution of social behavior, including human social behavior, depends on the evolution of the capacity for cooperation. Cooperation can evolve as the result of kin selection, reciprocal altruism, and group selection. All three of these processes have contributed to the cooperative behavior of social animals, including humans, and all three are fully compatible with and explained by modern evolutionary theory. In kin selection, social behavior and cooperation increases in frequency because, by cooperating with closely related individuals, those individuals increase the probability that their genes will increase in frequency in their population over time, even if they themselves do not directly benefit from such cooperation. Parents do this all the time, sacrificing their own fitness to benefit their offspring. In the parlance of evolutionary theory, they do this because, in the past, the genes of those individuals who have sacrificed part or all of their individual fitness for the sake of their offspring have increased relative to the genes of purely selfish individuals. Siblings and other close kin also benefit from this kind of unselfish cooperation, which is why this kind of cooperative behavior is often called kin selection. However, there are numerous examples of animals that cooperate with individuals and groups to whom they are not closely genetically related. For example, there are many examples of animals that cooperate with animals, or even plants that are not closely related to them at all, as in the incredibly close relationship between ants and acacia trees in Africa. There is a species of acacia tree in Africa called whistling thorns that are inhabited by ant species that protect the trees from insects and other herbivores that might eat or otherwise damage the trees and leaves. In return for this protection, the acacia trees produce bulbous thorns, where the ants lay their eggs and raise their young. The trees even provide food for the ants in the form of nectar secreting at the bases of some of their leaves. Such mutualistic symbioses are examples of what Robert Trivers called reciprocal altruism. "I'll scratch your back if you scratch mine" is a succinct way of stating the underlying principle of reciprocal altruism. Cooperative actions between unrelated individuals can become more frequent if the cooperative acts are reciprocated. As we learned in our first series of lectures, reciprocal altruism can result in elaborate mutualistic symbioses, and they don't depend upon either love or respect or even trust. All that is necessary for reciprocal altruism to evolve is repeated interactions between individuals who can remember each other, what happened the last time they interacted, and who can respond to each other by doing essentially the same thing in return. Finally, there's at least one other means by which cooperation can evolve in social animals, including humans: group selection. In the early 1970s, George R. Price proposed a theory of group selection in which the tendency to commit genuinely unselfish altruistic acts, that is, acts that benefit neither one's close kin nor are reciprocated in kind, can be selected for if such acts increase the overall fitness of the group of which the altruists are members. As Price's famous covariance equation shows, as long as a group benefits more from the acts of its altruistic members than a competing group benefits from the acts of its more selfish members, the average fitness of the group members in the altruistic groups will increase. As we will see later in this lecture series, this last form of cooperation, sacrificing individual fitness for the good of the group, is the basis for both extremely, almost saintly altruism and also for the most violent form of group behavior known: intergroup warfare and genocide. In the imaginary world of mathematical models, only one evolutionary process at a time, either competition or cooperation, but not both, is usually assumed to predominate. Otherwise, the math gets too complicated and often less predictable. But in the real world, competition and cooperation are almost never exclusive. The availability of resources and the costs and benefits of individual and group cooperation in obtaining those resources strongly influence the blends of cooperation and competition that evolve in social groups. For example, comparative studies of the behavioral ecology of many different animal species has shown that resources that are abundant, clumped, predictable in time and space, and defendable are usually correlated with increased sociality, social stratification, and territoriality. Resources like these include such obvious things as food, water, and shelter. However, there are other less obvious things that qualify as resources, things such as access to potential mates, resting and sleeping space, and even access to the means of anti-predator defense. The amounts of such resources and how they are distributed have overwhelmingly important effects on how individuals treat each other, whether they cooperate to obtain and distribute or hoard such resources, or whether they struggle with each other to obtain their share, or some combination of these two. Furthermore, these patterns of resource availability and distribution are not static. A resource, such as migratory prey animals like salmon, or ripening grains, nuts, or fruits, can be superabundant at one time and place, and all but gone at another. Because resource availability and cost-benefit relationships can change over time, patterns of competition and cooperation within and between social groups also change over time. Animals that live a relatively short time or do not move around much during their lifetimes do not need to be particularly adaptable to changes in resource availability. Such animals can specialize in very restricted resources and still survive, and can do so without needing to have much behavioral flexibility to respond to changes. For example, there are many species of insects that are so highly specialized in obtaining resources from a restricted source that they're restricted to obtaining those resources from a very few or even one source. There are moths that are adapted to obtaining nectar from only one species of flowering plant. As long as those plants are available, the moths flourish. If they're no longer available, the moths suffer or even go extinct. And because the flowers hardly vary at all, the food-gathering behaviors of the moths are almost entirely wired in to the animal's nervous systems. Indeed, to do otherwise, to have to learn to identify different food sources and where and when they're available, takes time, effort, and most of all, energetically expensive neurological processing power. Under such conditions, a mostly genetic, hardwired moth has a distinct evolutionary advantage over one that has to learn how to make its living. But in long-lived, highly social animals such as humans, changes in patterns of competition and cooperation within and between social groups are more often culturally learned rather than innate and genetically wired into the nervous system. Animals that live a long time or who move around a lot are much more likely to encounter changing conditions and new situations. Wiring in enough behavioral responses to such changes would take time and would still limit the behavioral flexibility of such animals to conditions that existed for relatively long periods of time during the animal's evolutionary past. Complex nervous systems with the ability to learn new behaviors, new ways of making a living, and able to pass that learning on would therefore pay for themselves in the long run. So, we should expect to observe more behavioral flexibility and especially more learned behaviors among long-lived, highly mobile animals, and especially those that live in complex social groups. However, this doesn't mean that we can't make predictions and find correlations between the patterns of resource availability and the kinds of behaviors animals use to obtain those resources. We can still correlate social behavior patterns with environmental influences, remaining aware that such patterns can change surprisingly quickly, especially in evolutionary terms. Perhaps the most noticeable and familiar social structures observed in social animals are dominance hierarchies. The word hierarchy originally referred to the kind of social structure that characterized the religions of the Greek, Roman, and other empires. Indeed, the higher part of the word refers specifically to the hierophant, or head of a religious order, an archy comes from the same root word from which we get arch, that is, the top. A hierarchy is a social order in which some individuals, and sometimes only one, are leaders and the rest are followers. In a later lecture, we will examine the religious implications of this concept of hierarchy and its importance for social cohesion. A dominance hierarchy is a hierarchical social structure that is enforced via displays of dominance or by actual fighting for supremacy, all of it for the pinnacle of the hierarchy. A dominance hierarchy can be linear, like the pecking order of hens in a chicken coop. There's a top chicken who pecks all the other hens to force them to let her do what she wants, usually have her choice of food, water, and roosting space. There's a lieutenant chicken who pecks all the other chickens except for the top chicken, and so forth on down to the little downtrodden chicken who's pecked by everybody but pecks nobody. Many dominance hierarchies are linear in the way that chicken pecking orders are linear and top-down. There may also be linear dominance hierarchies in both sexes, one for the males and one for the females. Wolf packs, for example, typically have a dominant or alpha male who regularly forces all of the other wolves in the pack, but especially the other males, to submit to him. There's also an alpha female who does the same thing among the females in the pack. Not surprisingly, the alpha male and female are often a mated pair, and in many cases are also the parents, or grandparents, or uncles and aunts, of the other more subordinate members of the pack. Dominance hierarchies can also be pyramidal, in which a dominant individual, or sometimes a few individuals, dominate all of those below them, but not necessarily in linear order. In such hierarchies, there are often levels of dominance, within which individuals are constantly jockeying for position and testing their level mates for signs of submission. Virtually all social animals, from ants to elephants, form dominance hierarchies. Furthermore, and to complicate this picture even more, there can be, and in humans and other primates often are, dominance hierarchies of groups, in which one social group as a whole is dominant over another social group. In such metadominant societies, individuals within groups must keep track of their positions in their own hierarchy, but must also be aware of the dominance position of their group vis-a-vis other nearby social groups. This takes an immense amount of neural processing power, and may be one explanation, indeed, perhaps the principal explanation, for the large brains of social animals living in dominance hierarchies. And, like the signals that animals, including humans, use to communicate readiness to fight, mate, or run away, the signals that communicate our positions in a hierarchy and our ability and willingness to defend those positions are often both complex and unconscious. Indeed, the less conscious they are, the less processing power they use, and therefore the more effective they can be. Finally, to add yet another level of complexity, dominance hierarchies can also be context-dependent. That is, the structure of the hierarchy can depend upon what the group is doing. It can shift rather abruptly if the group changes the focus of its behavior. For example, in many hunter-gatherer societies, the person who is chief, that is, the top of the hierarchy, for one activity, such as hunting, may not be chief when the group switches to another activity. The chief hunter, almost always a man, is sometimes not the chief for war, virtually always a man, but not necessarily the same man, who is almost never the chief for gathering plant foods, often, but not always, a woman, and so forth. Human societies are so complex and specialization for different roles is often so highly developed that individuals must keep track of the different context-dependent dominance hierarchies within the group and between groups. No wonder we need such large brains and long memories. Dominance hierarchies are so ubiquitous and their forms so familiar that most people are either not aware of them or consider them to be as natural as gravity. Indeed, research has shown that most people can pick out the leader of a group within a minute of entering that group. One of the things that make dominance relationships so easy to keep track of is that dominance hierarchies are often spatialized. that is, dominant individuals, are visualized as being higher, and submissive individuals as lower. As Charles Darwin first pointed out in his book, Expression of the Emotions in Men and Animals, dominance relationships are often communicated by higher and lower postures. Dogs, for example, communicate dominance by standing taller, arching their necks, pricking up their ears, holding their tails high, and erecting their fur, all of which gives an impression of greater height. Submissive dogs communicate their submission by doing the opposite, by cringing down low or even rolling on the ground, lowering their heads, flattening their ears and hair, and tucking their tails between their legs. What specific signals do humans look for to indicate relative dominance? First, males more often compete for dominance than females, and so most people tend to identify males as the dominant members of social groups. In addition to being male, dominant individuals are often taller and sometimes larger as well, especially when dominance is determined by physical contests. There's a myriad of signals that humans use to communicate dominance, from upright, even puffed-out chest-high posture, to tone of voice, to whether they step on other people's sentences rather than pausing before speaking. Dominant individuals touch submissive individuals more often, gesture more broadly, point at other people, and speak directly to them while making sustained eye contact. All of these signals, combined with the verbal content of one's speech, communicates volumes about one's perceived position in a dominance hierarchy. Why do social groups so often resolve into dominance hierarchies? Well, clearly part of the answer is that dominant individuals have a lot to gain from their position at the top of the hierarchy. Empirical studies have repeatedly shown that dominant individuals have relatively greater access to resources, especially mates, and also have relatively more offspring than individuals lower in the hierarchy. Indeed, so tight is the relationship between dominance and reproductive success that intra-group dominance hierarchies are usually associated with polygynous mating systems, in which dominant males monopolize more than an equal share of the females, their offspring, and the resources necessary to successfully raise them to adulthood. For these reasons, it has generally been observed that males benefit much more from dominant interactions than females. We've already seen how female choice during mating can be strongly influenced by male versus male contests for access to females. In hierarchical societies, dominant males have a lot to gain from a position at the top of their dominance hierarchy. As the asymmetries of female choice implied, there's much more variance in male reproductive success than among females. And there's a correspondingly increased variance in males' reproductive success correlated with their position in a hierarchy. Dominant males have more female mates and more children, and their sons inherit both their social position and the behavioral traits that secured it for their fathers. It's obvious why dominant individuals participate in dominance interactions in a hierarchy, but why do submissive individuals, including females, go along with this as well? Why don't they just leave the group and strike out on their own? Well, sometimes they do. Comparative studies of male and female emigration patterns have indicated a consistent bias toward female emigration from social groups compared with males. That is, if an individual leaves a particular area or group, that individual is significantly more likely to be female than male, a pattern that holds for many species of birds and mammals, including, at least possibly, humans. There are several reasons why individuals lower in a dominance hierarchy, especially females, may play along in their subordinate role rather than going it alone. One obvious reason is that if social interaction is a necessary prerequisite for success in obtaining resources, then the only alternative may indeed be death. As many studies of social animals, and especially social predators such as wolves, have shown, a lone wolf is a dead wolf. If social interaction is necessary for survival, then submission to a lower position in a dominance hierarchy is better than death or having no offspring, which from an evolutionary standpoint are essentially the same thing. This is particularly true for females who require male assistance in raising their offspring. No matter how onerous a female's position in a dominance hierarchy, if membership in a group is a prerequisite to successful reproduction, females will more often tolerate their subordinate position. But being a subordinate member of a dominance hierarchy isn't necessarily that bad. Subordinate members of dominance hierarchies, both male and female, can benefit indirectly from the increased inclusive fitness of their more dominant kin. Among many polygynous species, males band together to become the dominant males in a polygynous group. Furthermore, such male-male cooperation may be enhanced by kin selection. For example, among wild turkeys, males often band together to become the top turkeys for a flock of hens. And those males, more often than not, are brothers. Even though one brother does the lion's share of the mating, the other brother's genes gain via their brother's reproductive success. Speaking of lion shares, the same phenomenon occurs among African lions. A lion pride consists of an alpha female, her sisters, daughters, granddaughters, and their cubs, plus one or two dominant males. These males are often a pair of brothers who have driven off or killed the previous dominant male or males of the pride, killed all of the young cubs, thereby forcing the females into estrus, and mated with the females, thereby ensuring that all of the new cubs will be their offspring. One of the brothers does almost all of the mating, but from the standpoint of inclusive fitness, the subordinate brother is still much more successful than a male who cannot take over a pride of females by himself. Does the same phenomenon happen in humans? The short answer to this question is that we don't really have enough data to be able to say yes or no. There are societies that have been studied by anthropologists in which a pair of brothers marries a female with whom they have children. There are also tantalizing hints that an even more cooperative mating system may exist among families in which identical twin brothers marry identical twin sisters. Much more research into this phenomenon may help evolutionary psychologists separate the lions from the turkeys, but one thing is almost certain. Whatever we discover will almost certainly be surprising. Not only do subordinate members of dominance hierarchies benefit from their inclusive fitness with their more dominant kin, they may also benefit from simply staying the course. Multiple studies of polygynous animals have shown that males who assist other males in securing breeding rights to a female or group of females often succeed to the position of first mate when the dominant male dies, becomes ill, is driven off, or for some other reason stops monopolizing the females in their shared group. Under such circumstances, it is quite common for males to exhibit delayed maturation. That is, they do not reach sexual maturity until significantly later than females or comparable males in non-polygynous species. Both dominant and subordinate males can benefit from such delayed maturation. They can spend more time learning social dynamics, especially via play behavior and subadult rehearsal for dominance contests. Delayed maturation can also allow for increased body size, intelligence, physical prowess, especially among males. The extraordinarily long period of maturation to adulthood in humans is indirect evidence of the extraordinary importance of dominance hierarchies in human societies. And the delayed maturation of human males compared with females is another clue to our polygynous ancestry and the importance of social learning and human reproductive success. But, as you might expect, it gets even more complicated. If dominance is primarily the result of physical development, dominant individuals can also benefit from accelerated development. The sooner a male reaches his full adult size and level of physical skills, the sooner he can establish himself as the top dog in his social group, and therefore the more offspring he could potentially sire. These conflicting tendencies can result in an equilibrium between accelerated and delayed development, which can shift depending on environmental conditions. And, as both theoretical models and empirical research have shown, shifting equilibria are more likely to be the result of epigenetic than genetic determinants. That is, shifting equilibria, such as the ever-changing equilibrium between accelerated and delayed maturation in human males, is more likely the result of environment and changes in development rather than genetics. Is there a lot of fighting in dominance hierarchies? As Conrad Lorenz pointed out in his landmark book On Aggression, dominance and submission are more often mediated via conspicuous displays rather than direct physical competition, especially aggression and violence. As we've already seen, among long-lived animals, displays of dominance rather than direct competition are likely to evolve, as this benefits subordinate individuals who are usually younger and can eventually move up as their superiors age out. For this reason, the intensity of competition for dominance is often age-dependent. The intensity of competition increases with age from childhood through adolescence. During childhood, dominant males can increase the fitness of their male offspring by cooperating rather than competing with them. As males reach sexual maturity, competitive contests reach maximum intensity, tapering off when relative ranking in the hierarchy has been stabilized. While dominant males are in peak condition and their rank in the hierarchy has stabilized, direct contests are relatively rare, and ritualized dominance displays are common. Eventually, as dominant males age, they are increasingly challenged by subordinate males until they either cede their position in the hierarchy, are driven off, or die. This pattern holds as well for elephant seals and African lions, as well as it does for many human societies. Furthermore, in closely related social groups, subordinate individuals can also benefit from increased kin selection, resulting from decreased competition with higher-ranking kin. In extreme cases, this can result in the evolution of non-reproductive subordinates whose cooperation with their dominant kin results in their increased inclusive but not individual fitness. So, life in a dominance hierarchy isn't one long battle of each against all, but rather a constantly shifting pattern of increasingly subtle competition and cooperation in which communication, rather than violence, is the norm. What's the relationship between dominance and social status? In human social groups, position in a dominance hierarchy is usually signaled by indicators of social status, rather than direct contests. Many of the indicators of human social status are at least partially innate. Both males and females compete for status, more often within than between their genders. Like the signals that communicate position in a dominance hierarchy, many indicators of male social status are linked to increased reproductive success. Indicators of male social status include physical size, height, verbal behavior, gaze, posture, touching of subordinates, facial structure and expression, and especially the number of wives and sexual partners and children. Male social status is linked with increased testosterone and serotonin levels, which are also correlated with increased competitiveness, aggression, and violent behavior. Many indicators of female social status are linked to the status of their affiliated males. Females also use group cooperation, volunteerism, and moral sanction as means of indicating social status. Both males and females use possessions, especially clothing and personal adornment, as indicators of social status. Advertising is largely based on a blend of innate and culturally defined displays of social status and reproductive fitness. Dominance hierarchies can form at the level of competing groups as well as competing individuals. As we learned in the first series of lectures, group selection theory predicts that intra-group cohesion can result in increased fitness of group measures when in competition with other social groups. George R. Price's covariance theory of group selection strongly suggests that selection at the level of groups can have fitness consequences for individuals within those groups, as well as for groups as a whole. This is particularly the case when ecological circumstances favor intra-group cohesion and cooperation over intra-group competition. Throughout most of human evolutionary history, people have lived in small groups of closer related kin, whose primary subsistence depended upon foraging rather than agriculture. Foraging, a combination of hunting without keeping animals as domesticated animals, and gathering without planting and harvesting, is an intensely social activity, especially when foraging success depends upon cooperation. Both food gathering and hunting can be either solitary or social, depending on the distribution of food sources in the environment. In many human societies, food gathering and hunting can vary in intensity and importance over both space and time, with corresponding shifts in social structure. Exploitation of resources that require group cohesion and cooperation, such as hunting large prey, or defending territories with abundant clumped and defendable resources, such as migratory fish or plant foods with synchronized maturation, favors strong intra-group cohesion and equally strong intergroup competition. Forcibly taking resources from other social groups and defending against such forcible taking also favors strong intra-group cohesion. As we will see later in this lecture series, warfare, defined as the forcible taking of resources of one group by the combined social actions of another group, is an intensely social activity in which group selection plays an extremely important role. And, as we've already seen, the formation and maintenance of stable dominance hierarchies also favors strong intra-group cohesion, as long as there are no extreme asymmetries in intra-group resource allocation. It should not come as a surprise to discover that warfare and dominance hierarchies are almost always associated with each other. And the same is true for religion. More about that in a later lecture as well. There is one more behavior that is almost as ubiquitous as the formation of dominance hierarchies: the formation and maintenance of territories. The establishment and defense of territories have fitness consequences for both individuals and social groups. Humans have been obsessed with territory and territorial defense, not to mention territorial expansion, since before recorded history. The earliest written historical records are almost entirely chronicles of disputes over territory, from the Fertile Crescent of the Middle East to the Great Plains of Central Asia and North America. It would be safe to say that more has been spoken and written, and more blood, sweat, and tears have been shed in defense of territory or territorial expansion than any other human activity, except possibly sex. As Woody Allen succinctly put it, human behavior is all about love and death. To ecologists and evolutionary biologists, home ranges and territories are two different but related things. A home range is a particular geographical location within which an individual or social group spends most or all of its time and obtains most or all of its resources. But a territory is a particular geographical location that an individual or social group defends against the intrusion of other individuals or non-group members. Territories are almost always subsets of home ranges and usually contain most or all of the essential resources needed by the individuals or groups defending them. Establishment of defensive territories, like the establishment and maintenance of dominance hierarchies, depends on the abundance, clumping, predictability, and defendability of available resources in a particular geographical location. Abundant, clumped, predictable, and defendable resources favor territoriality, whereas scarce, or superabundant, dispersed, unpredictable, and undefendable resources do not. In general, foraging hunter-gatherers are not particularly territorial, especially if their food sources are seasonally superabundant or migratory. Examples include the huge hunting camps of the Plains Indians of North America, which formed during bison migrations and dispersed when the bison dispersed. During parts of the year when food resources are clumped or fixed in space and time, foraging hunter-gatherers can become much more territorial, both within and between groups. Agriculture typically produces locally abundant, clumped, and defendable resources, and so is usually associated with moderate to intense territoriality, especially between competing social groups. Agriculture therefore sets the stage for the evolution of warfare, as it increases the payoff for forcibly taking resources from individuals and groups. As we will see, warfare immensely enhances the benefits accruing from within-group cohesion, increased dominance, and increased territoriality. With the development of agriculture, politics, defined as the deliberate manipulation of group cohesion through behavioral displays, public communication, and resource distribution in the context of dominance hierarchies, became an inescapable part of human social behavior. However, as we will see in the next lecture, politics is much older than agriculture. Indeed, it's older than the human species itself. And politics is often, perhaps almost always, associated with intergroup competition, up to and including warfare.
This ends Lecture 1. Evolutionary Psychology Part 2, The Science of Human Nature, Friends and Enemies, Lecture 2, Primate Politics.
As we learned in the very first lecture of our first lecture series, one of the methods commonly used to formulate and test hypotheses in evolutionary psychology is interspecies comparisons. Such comparisons can elucidate evolutionary trends that can be applied to other species living in similar ecological circumstances. In simple terms, similar causes produce similar effects. For this reason, evolutionary psychologists have long studied chimpanzees and other apes, seeking lessons about our own behavior. There are two reasons for doing this. The apes are our closest relatives among the primates, and it is believed that our own ancestors evolved in environments similar to those in which apes still live. Of the apes, the two species of chimpanzees, Pan troglodytes and Pan paniscus, often called bonobos, are more closely related to humans than any of the other primates. This close relationship is shown not only in similarities of anatomy, but also very close similarities in genetics. Most recent estimates place the degree of genetic similarity between chimpanzees and ourselves at greater than 95%. That is, chimpanzees and humans differ by significantly less than 5% of our genetic material. Paleoecologists, scientists who study ancient ecologies, usually by studying fossils and biogeography, have also collected data that indicates that our ancestors lived in very similar ecological circumstances as present-day chimpanzees. Both chimpanzees and humans evolved in equatorial Africa, in tropical rainforest habitats interspersed with patches of woodlands, that is, grassy open areas with scattered trees. Chimpanzees today remain adapted to the tropical rainforest environment of equatorial Africa, whereas the fossil evidence indicates that our ancestors became adapted to woodland ecosystems first, and then branched out to grasslands and coastal environments. Since chimpanzees have apparently changed much less over the 6 million years in which our own species has diverged from the common ancestor that we share with them, most researchers believe that studying chimpanzee behavior can yield insights into what our own ancestors were like. Perhaps the best-known researcher in this field is Jane Goodall, who studied the chimpanzees in the Gombe Stream National Park in Tanzania for over 40 years. Beginning in the early 1960s, Goodall and her co-workers studied wild populations of common chimpanzees, species Pan troglodytes. The other chimpanzee, called the bonobo or pygmy chimpanzee, species Pan paniscus, was studied later by other researchers. Goodall and her colleagues studied common chimpanzees in their natural setting and social groupings, either by following them through the forest or watching them at feeding stations, where the chimpanzees were fed fruit, especially bananas. Some scientists, principally Margaret Powers, have suggested that the latter practice introduced an artificial element into the chimpanzees' environment, causing unnatural reactions and especially increased aggression at feeding stations. However, studies carried out at locations where such feeding was not done have indicated that the behavior of chimpanzees at the feeding stations in the Gombe Stream National Park has not been significantly altered by artificial feeding. Among Goodall's major discoveries are that chimpanzees use specially fashioned tools and hunt other animals in cooperative groups. Prior to Goodall's observations of the chimpanzees of Gombe, the majority of scientists believed that tool using was a uniquely human trait. However, Goodall observed chimpanzees using grass blades and stalks stripped of branches to fish for termites in termite mounds. The chimpanzees, usually females and their young offspring, would select a grass blade or stalk, then modify it by trimming it for length and stripping off extra leaves. Then the
chimps would. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.